street, they call it weather.
And I'm heading out to ride towards Kailasagiri. Something that I've gone there before, but let me just check if it's recording. Hold on. Yeah, recording it is on. So let's vamanos. Yeah, so since you guys have been asking for Xpulse videos and I haven't posted in a while, I thought I'd shoot one today. I've ridden with Bhagat Motors, which is a dealership of Hero, to Kailasagiri before, and it was a pretty decent ride. Today the weather is like quite overcast, so I thought even if it's late it doesn't matter, I'll stop somewhere and eat something and we probably make it back home for a late lunch. I don't know much about the history of Kailasagiri. All I know is that there's a cave temple there and probably a fort. Most of these places have forts at the top of the hill, so yep. We're just waiting at a signal right now. I'm wearing these new Maverick Fly adventure boots that my dear friend Mr. Rohit Reddy got down from the US, and I'm finding it a little difficult to shift gears, even though this is the Rally Edition. It apparently has a bigger gear shift, but I can't see that at this point. Okay, we're off, and I'm shifting too many gears. My feel for my feet are not, this is not something I'm used to. I think I'm riding on the brake also a little bit, so I have to watch it. Yeah. All right, and we are off towards KR Puram. There's a lake. Railway tracks. You see, we work there. There's a lake here. Yeah. I don't know what the government does with all these lakes. Yeah, I can see a pathway that people walk around. That's nice. Unfortunately, Hebbal and there's another place there called some gardens, I can't remember now. That lake is completely shut off to the public. We're going to be crossing the KR Puram bridge. Slow ride. I'm not in my most comfortable element because of these boots. Kind of, this is a braking and ride for them. So I also get used to, you know, how it is to ride with them. Ever since I got this bike, I wanted to get some ADV gear. And while I've not got everything, I don't have a dirt track helmet. I don't have an adventure helmet. I've got like something that's in between. Like I've got an old helmet that I put on, goggles onto, ADV goggles. But you know, with an ADV helmet, you have a larger mouthpiece, so it doesn't tend to fog up as much, and probably ventilation is better. But the problem is with those helmets, when you ride on the highway, if you're doing anywhere close to 100, you're going to have a lot of wind buffeting, and it's going to be quite painful. I mean, for now, I think this helmet that I'm using right now is good enough. And honestly, at these speeds, there's barely any wind buffeting that I can hear. Yes, I am wearing small cotton plugs today. But yeah, wow, the weather is beautiful, huh? Here, I should reach Kailasagiri by 1:30. The thing with these adventure boots is they restrict, you know, ankle movement like to a zero. It's a safety feature, but. You know, on a motorcycle, you need to move your feet to, you know, change gears and use the rear brake. This kind of constricts that.
This is first guys are like turning in and blocking all the traffic, bro. Such assholes, bro. Look at him, how he's turning. They don't care if other people, if they block the whole world. This is civic sense in India for you.
That time I'm seeing him fucking grandu bastard. Sorry. Sorry, I've got a little bit of a mouth. Oh, this would never have happened if I had my other boots, my normal boots on. I'm missing gears also. It's okay. This ride, every ride is a learning experience, especially when you try out new gear and something new, you know. You've got to just be able to adapt. Which is why I'm not belting and riding like I usually do on this bike.
The problem with the GoPro is that even though it's waterproof, once you put on the mic adapter, you have to take off the battery gate, and then it's not really waterproof. So that's one issue. Okay, getting a hang of it.
Right. There's a right that everybody sticks to the left to take. You see?
the animality of this country. So, not this country, sorry, this city.
I've been to other cities, I've lived in other cities. People follow lanes, you know. In this city, look at it. Nobody follows lanes. And there are no markers also to really signify, you know, stick on this side or whatever. Anyway, doesn't matter. So yeah, the road is finally opened up. Quite boring, huh? This bike is not very fast. So if this bike had like a more powerful engine and a 6th gear, it would be perfect. Problem is, you can't have everything in one package, no? Otherwise you'd just buy one bike. So yeah, this is where it falls short when you compare it with the KTM and the... I don't know if the Suzuki 250 is... Yeah, I mean, it should be better. This is a 200. But it makes a lot less power than most 200s. I believe the Suzuki is a very good power plant. But I didn't like it. I like this bike better. Just before I left, I got a call from the service center asking me to come and, you know, service the bike. Maybe I need to stick to the other lane. I'll stick in the middle, dude. Let them fly by me, no? I'm in top gear. Just chilling. I hope it doesn't rain when I reach there. It's always nice to... Oh wow, what is this? It's like some resort. There's guys coming up. Guys Brewery, Old Madras Road. Sir, you want to overtake me, sir? When I am on the extreme left? By coming into my lane? One of my favorite brew pubs, they make some good beer. They brew some good beer. And they have some really killer starters and snacks and stuff. One motorcycle not going to return hangi. This going into neutral is a dangerous scene, dude, because people think I'm accelerating and then suddenly I'm deaccelerating. I don't like it. Here is Geist. By the way, this bike is completely stock. Bone stock. There is not a single thing that I've done to this other than putting this mobile phone holder. I'm getting a fumigation here with this bus. Quite frustrating not to ride through traffic. The Xpulse has got a good amount of grunt, a good amount of low end torque. Oh, what's up, dude? What's up with the traffic here? Frustrating, man. These are the outskirts of Bangalore. Like, my ankles are starting to hurt, shifting gears. I don't know how these motocross guys do it, yeah. They keep knocking down the gears and shifting up, knocking down, shifting up. Crazy. I guess these need to bed in a bit. Okay, so I'm 1 hour away, which is not bad. Just need to get out of the traffic first, then I think everything will be good. I'm carrying a raincoat and rain pants and stuff. I don't know if the rain pants will fit over these boots. These adventure riding boots are not completely waterproof. They don't have like a zipper. It's got a little bit of a membrane, but they're not really waterproof, so rains, these boots are gonna get soaked. utter rubbish. I don't think it's a good idea to go from here. Again, some other jam, dude. Always getting caught in the jammies. Some big clouds might rain very heavily later. I might not be able to escape because I'm going to take 1 hour to reach. But it's nice to ride.
My experience with the ownership of this bike has been pretty undramatic, pretty good, pretty nice. I don't abuse this bike. I basically use it as a regular commuter, and it's serving me very well in my commutes. Now, for example, today I'm going to be riding a little bit off-road, so I'm taking it there as well. And yeah, I've done about 2,755 kilometers in 1 year, which is rare or less. So the bike is being pretty much baby, not abused, taken care of well. There are a few scratches on the mirrors and on the exhaust shield, because I have a little bit of a tight parking spot for this bike, and gears, man, irritating gears. Find a way how to go now. Wow, big clouds, huh? Alright. So, in terms of my experience with this bike, I'm very happy. This speed, 77, 78 to 80, you don't feel the vibes, it will keep pulling. There's a lot of torque on this, on the Xpulse, because of the gearing. It's geared pretty short. So even in third, fourth gear, it will pull. When it comes to issues I've had with this bike, I would say barely any. I've had one issue with this switchgear console here. I think it's got to do with this. So let me see if the horn works today. Horn is working, okay. Yesterday while riding, suddenly the horn stopped working, this button stopped working, and then it started working again. Like it has a brain of its own. This switchgear also controls the headlights. So there have been times when there have also been times where the headlight, the high beam comes on by default, just suddenly, and that's been a little bit of an irritation, and it will go off also on its own in some time, but this is what I've experienced. Terminal, cafe, kitchen and bar, a lot of restaurants, you see, and if you take this left, you go towards Devanahalli. You go straight to the airport, and we are going towards, this is the route we are taking, goes towards Chennai. So this road is going to go, if I'm not mistaken, I'm not sure. I think maybe if you take that road and you go straight, that goes towards, no, that comes around. So this is the road that goes to Chennai then, I think. Oh, it's poured here very recently. The roads are a little wet. I feel raindrops on my visor. Punjabi Dhaba, oye hoye, chakta fate. Breakfast giant.
when it comes to comfort, seat and all, I don't have any problem per se. Though I don't really, haven't done a lot of long distance riding on this bike, so it would not be appropriate for me to say, but right now I can feel a little fatigue in my bump. A little bit of fatigue. What I could do is I could get the rally seat, which has a lot more cushion and is taller. Might make maneuvering the bike in traffic more challenging. We are in top gear. So yeah, I mean, you can push this bike to do close to 100, but it's not very happy there. Happiest like around 80, 90 maybe. Beyond that, it starts feeling stressed. That also could be because of the sprocketing. The sprocketing is geared, the bike is geared to more for acceleration than highway speeds. If I had taken the Interceptor, it would have been a breeze blasting on these roads. I would have been around, say, doing 100. But this road is not very fast also, as you can probably make out. And always ride with mirrors on the highway. It's a blessing. It's not just a blessing, it's actually essential to be able to see what people behind you are doing. For a very long time, I used to be one of those guys who used to take off mirrors, because you know, when you ride in the city, it's not that critical, but when you're on the highway, it's supremely important. When I say it's not really important in the city, is because in the city, a bike is usually moving faster than a car, you know, in small confined spaces. And in that sense, you're pretty much ahead of everyone else. But still, you know, there could be another bike who could be right behind you, probably trying to overtake you, and you know, that's, yeah. I'm starting to feel hungry. Let me see if I find a nice spot somewhere to stop. This is the road that goes to Mulvagal also, but we're not going that far. You see, this guy has his mirrors closed, so he won't even know that I'm there. Saddle. Stretch my legs out a bit. Take off some pressure from my butt. Oh, the clouds look nasty here, brah. You see, it's doing 83 in fifth gear at around 6000 RPM. My red line is at 8.5, and I'm not taking it there in top gear. I don't feel the need to. But this is okay. I had some plans to do some stuff with this bike. I wanted to put in a air filter from Engage. I wanted to put in a few legs, and I want to put on a Norifumi. I think a Norifumi Rocket 4 or something exhaust. That's what I want to do. But some left on inside. Yeah, I wanted to do some of that, but decided against it. Passing to take this left. Shall we do it? This looks like some inside village road. Let me just stop and check once. Through some village back roads, passing through some farms. This road might not be in the best shape, but it's okay. I like these back roads. Inspection timer. Inspector gadgets. All the dogs are inspecting his gadgets. neutral. Progress may be a little slow. Cabbage farms. Yeah, but talking about the bike again, you know, in terms of handling, in terms of comfort, this bike is really good. Mileage is also unbelievable. I would say shortcomings would be it's a little hard to say what the shortcomings are. Quality definitely is a shortcoming. I've noticed. I have noticed spots of rust on my rims. The bike is like barely 1 year old. I have not abused this bike. It's not seen salt water and all of that. So I don't know how that rust spot has come. It also, you know, the issue I mentioned with the switch gear, butterflies everywhere here. And and generally I feel like the lack of power is a bit of a issue. I mean, it could have been really nice if it had more power, right? I mean, who would complain? But it doesn't. So in that sense, you know, maybe the Triumph Scrambler 400 is a more versatile bike, because it has good enough power for the highway, and it's got power for and it's got decent enough suspension to take you off-road, you know. The farmer's plowing his field, having a chat with his pal, putting some khaini. Minutes more. I want to stop somewhere for lunch or a snack at least. So yeah, I mean, other than the power, so the power, that's what I was thinking, you know, because of the lack of power, I do that, I do these things, which are all plug and play mods. I'm not thinking about a big bore and all. I know Nissar is like really good at it. He sells a lot of kits, but I don't want to mess with the engine. Honestly, I don't want to mess with the warranty, because my confidence in this bike is little lower than say the Royal Enfield, because of something as basic as quality, right? I mean, when you touch the Royal Enfield switchgear, it's a high quality product. I mean, I know the Triumph has very good build quality as well, but dude, people make a lot of fun of Royal Enfields. I was one of those guys when I didn't have the Interceptor. When the Interceptor had not been launched, I was a very big critic of Royal Enfield. I should laugh at them, because obviously, you know, I have an RD350 and it's a faster, better, meaner bike. In terms of quality, the Interceptor is of much, much more premium quality, from the chrome to the, you know, the parts that they've used, some of which are not manufactured by Royal Enfield. You know, the parts that they've selected are of top quality, and obviously they are also charging that kind of a price. The Interceptor is today is about 2 lakhs more than the Xpulse. When I bought it, it was probably 1.5 lakh more than the Xpulse. The Xpulse at that time also was 2V, so it was cheaper. Now they've bumped up the prices. I have not ridden the 2V, so I don't know how the 2V is on the highway. It's a 2-valve, this is a 4-valve. I believe this breathes better, has better better top end performance, if you can call it that. The 2V apparently has more torque, better emission. So yeah, doing mods like putting in a fuel X and an air filter and an exhaust would definitely de-restrict the bike. It would make it maybe a little more peppy to ride. Would it change it dramatically? I don't think so. But truth be told, honestly, at this point, I don't for my use case, I'm taking this bike, I think for the second time in 1 year, to this place called Kailasagiri. So does it warrant, you know, all these mods for my use case, given that I mostly use this bike to travel in the city? No, I don't think so. So that's the reason I've not gone ahead with it. Also, I mean, the fuel ex for this bike is like maybe what, 11,000, and I mean, I'm looking for a good deal. If I can get somebody who wants to sell a fuel ex, I'm always open to it. That's how I got the fuel ex on the Intercept. I found a guy who was selling it for half the price, and it was under warranty. So whatever, you know, whatever went wrong, also I got it replaced for free. And that worked out to be a good deal for me. God, gears are not. I need to get a feel. Yeah, you need to get a feel. I'm starting to get a feel now. I just got like a feel. I just recognize that feel. Yeah, it's taking some time to bed in. Now hopefully there won't be any. We're in top gear. Yeah, this bike gets to top gear pretty fast. So in that sense, it's a very efficient machine. You're always, you know, it has enough torque also to put you from like 60 whatever, even less than that. Mushrooms. Are we in Kodaikanal, bro? No? Go that side, no. Fucking idiot.
Last time I think we had stopped here only somewhere.
South Ruchi Veg. Alright, small pit stop. Why is that lady shouting like a bus conductor? Alright, I'm gonna pause recording. Thank you. Alright, what's up everyone? Just done with a quick snack. We are just half an hour away.
To go. Woo. That was a good break, much needed. My butt feels better. I think I'm holding gears a little longer. I'm not used to riding this bike in this kind of circumstances, you know. I mean, I can't really hear the engine because it's so soft. Those are the hills. Rear can lock up pretty easy. There's no ABS on the rear on the Xpulse, so you can wind up locking the rear pretty easy. But it's not frightening. In fact, you see, once I get up to the hill, it's better because the rear tends to slip and slide a little bit before it gets traction, and you know, the last time a bunch of villagers in this part of town. There's a bar around there. You can fuel up your vehicle and you can fuel yourself up also. That's Kailasagiri.
I think. But, I mean, unless there are a set of hills actually, small hillocks. Beautiful views, no, all around. So nice. Views always get better once you exit the city. Probably that hill. That is Kailasagiri, because we have to take a left ahead. Overtaking maneuvers around the Xpulse have to be planned well in advance. At least 5 minutes in advance. Or you can plan one day also, but yeah. There is the left. That has to be 4 kilometers. Okay. 15 minutes. Welcome to Chintamani town. Alright, here's where the off-road section begins.